In the 70s, there was metal. And then there was punk. I got a feeling inside of me. Two separate entities that rarely, if ever, mixed. However, a band both subcultures could agree on was Motorhead, led by the hoarse rumble of Lemmy. With their first three albums, they cemented their place as one of the loudest bands Britain has ever produced. But the lead single from their fourth album proved they could be metal heavy, mangle it with punk attitude, and still be able to cross over to the pop charts. This is New British Canon, and this is the story of Ace of Spades. The story of Motorhead is really the story of their only consistent member, Ian Frazier-Kilmister, known to the world at large as Lemmy. Falling for the rock and roll of Chuck Berry, Little Richard and Buddy Holly, the teenage Lemmy quickly observed the guitar's effect on the opposite sex. When I saw Buddy Holly play in 1958, I was there looking for girls. At that age, you want to get laid. I saw this English rock singer, Billy Fury. And he was surrounded by all these chicks, rubbing his crotch. I thought, that's the fucking job for me. Through the 60s, alongside roadieing for the Jimi Hendrix Experience, Lemmy had been in various bands as a guitarist, including the raucous freak beat of the Rocking Vickers. And the weirdo psychedelia of Sam Gopal. But he learned how to play bass after joining Space Rockers Hawkwind in August 1971. The band had a rotating lineup, with sometimes as many as 9 people on stage, including the 6'2" new dancer Stacia and resident poet Robert Calvert. Coming on like a dark shadow of the unremitting krautrock movement, Lemmy would describe Hawkwind in his autobiography as a black fucking nightmare. It was there that Lemmy developed his insistent, pulsing bass style, serving in Hawkwind as a hypnotic drone. But would later be the driving force within the Motorhead sound. Lemmy integrated himself into the group well enough, even singing on their biggest UK hit, Silver Machine, which reached number 3 in July 1972. But the rest of the band were into psychedelics like acid, and Lemmy preferred uppers like speed. This narcotic difference of opinion and the resultant mind states would increase tensions within the group. During my time with Hawkwind, I really came out of any show I may have been in, stage-wise. I was always at the front of the stage and showing off, and since I wasn't the leader of the band, it was considered most presumptuous. And I started to write songs, which I think pissed everybody off as well. In May 1975, Lemmy was caught on a drug possession charge at the Canadian border, and while the band paid his bail, it was only because they couldn't find a replacement in time for the next show. But with the charges later dropped and free from Hawkwind, he returned to London, stole as much of his previous band's equipment as he could, and formed a new band with himself as the frontman. Lemmy's new group were initially called Bastard, before someone alerted him that it would be difficult to get on Top of the Pops with that name. He instead titled the group after the last song he wrote in Hawkwind. Getting its name from the American verbiage for a speed freak, one that is unable to stop talking, Motorhead was written with Lemmy being in a similar state of mind while on Hawkwind's 1974 US tour. I don't remember the exact chronology of the night, but I was still up at 7 in the morning, howling away at the top of my voice. Loud, fast, raucous, speed freak, rock and roll. Motorhead! It was the perfect moniker for his new project. The initial lineup consisted of Lemmy on bass and vocals, the Pink Fairies' Larry Wallace on guitar, and Lucas Fox on drums. I wanted it to be sort of like the MC5, since that was the big hero band of most of the underground. And throw in elements of Little Richard and Hawkwind, and that's more or less how it turned out. We were a blues band, really. Although we played it at 1,000 miles per hour, it was recognisable as blues. At least to us it was. Though this outrageously loud new band was summarily mocked in the music press, Lemmy was never one to care what the NME, Sounds, or anyone else thought. Whereas some bands were all talk or playing a rock star character, Motorhead were literally amphetamine-fueled reprobates who cared little for anything that wasn't boozing, brawling, fucking, or rock and roll. And that came across in their music. That no-bullshit attitude and relentless touring with the likes of Blue Oyster Cult, Pink Fairies and Hawkwind gained them a small yet die-hard following amongst the biker set. Releasing their debut self-titled album in 1977, they also found like minds in the punk movement. Lemmy having tried to teach Sid Vicious to play bass, alongside the band sharing stages with The Damned and Adverts. Both punk and Motorhead were taking rock and roll back to its basics and revving it to breaking point. Like the punks, we just swept all that tedious 70s Rick Wakeman, artsy-fartsy, yellow bell-bottoms, caftans and sandals shit aside. If you hadn't seen what we looked like, you would have thought we were a punk band. After a rough first few years of record label fuckery, and being named Best Worst Band in the World by NME, Motorhead brought it together with their second and definitive lineup of Fast Eddie Clark on guitar and Filthy Animal Taylor on drums. In September 1978, their cover of proto-punk staple Louie Louie would be their first charting single, reaching number 68. Louie Louie. Their March 1979 second album, Overkill, demonstrated this consolidation of ideas, band members and sound. It was harder, faster, more in your face. The title track was their first to implement double bass drumming. Overkill. 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 A flourish that Taylor had promised himself not to indulge in until he learned how to play them. Rehearsing the thundering technique formed the basis for the track.
I was actually doing that, playing that riff, you know, just trying to get my coordination right, when Eddie and Lemmy, like, walked in, and I was just about to stop, and they went, no, 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 don't stop, keep going, keep going. And that was how Overkill got written.
Overkill would be the ensuing credo for the group. Why be simply loud when you can be louder than everything else? At their most deafening, the band surpassed 130 decibels at a concert in 1984, at which point the ceiling started to crack and the show had to be shut down as a safety precaution. This is approximately the same volume as a jet plane taking off. We're loud and rowdy, it's the only way we know how to be, but we are also very good at playing our instruments. Just because we have our amps turned right up, doesn't mean we're trying to hide our lack of talent behind a wall of noise. We can definitely play. This is a serious band. At the same time, a new generation of UK metal bands were starting to make ripples. The press called it the new wave of British heavy metal, and felt that Motorhead either fit into this movement, or were at least formative to its sound. Lemmy disagreed. I like Iron Maiden and Saxon out of the new mop, and that's about it really. We were too late for the first metal movement, and early for the next one. Motorhead don't fit into any category, really. We're not straight heavy metal, because we're a rock and roll band. Despite Motorhead's confrontational sound, they still managed to appeal to a mass audience. The Overkill album making its way to number 24 in June 1979, while the single went top 40, and allowed the band their second appearance on Top of the Pops. Overkill! 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 It was nice to be getting it across to the public, but the thing is, that show was always tacky. I think the audience on the show liked it, but when they're told to boogie, they boogie, so I don't know if it's true they liked it. The Top of the Pops crowd may have fake danced to Overkill, but 1980 would bring a Motorhead song that no one, not even the teeny boppers, could deny. For their two 1979 records, Overkill and Bomber, Motorhead had worked with Exile Main Street producer Jimmy Miller. However, the band felt that Bomber's production had lacked their trademark grit. If you listen to Bomber, the songs don't have the edge they have when we do them live. I can't say it's an album I am happy with. The songs are all good, but Jimmy Miller, well, we made the mistake of letting him do what he wanted without arguing. Sure, Bomber sold well, but I doubt we'll work with Jimmy again. He has his own demons to deal with, and it made him difficult and unreliable. Instead, for album 4, Motorhead teamed up with Vic Mail, who Lemmy had previously worked with when he engineered Hawkwind's Space Ritual live album. Since then, Mail had produced Down by the Jetty by Dr. Feelgood and the top 5 smash 2468 Motorway by Tom Robinson. Unlike the smack-addicted Miller, Mail was less prone to the excesses of rock and roll. He didn't drink, he didn't smoke, and he was very delicate because he was diabetic. We couldn't get heavy with him, couldn't fucking shake him, you know what I mean? He might die, so we had to listen to him. The unlikely pairing of Mayo and Motorhead would prove inspired. His soft-spoken manner was able to handle the group's infighting, but it also helped that it was a rock and roll savant, creating a sound that was just as nasty and pummeling as Motorhead were live, but in a way so that each element could be discerned and had its own punch. He certainly had his own ideas. He put his little bits in, little bits and bobs, and he would subtly just try to steer you a bit. Like if my guitar was a little too dirty, he wouldn't pull his punches, but he did it in a way where you didn't want to argue with him. Mail's most prominent influence was on what would become the album's title track, Ace of Spades. The band had rehearsed the track before entering Jackson's studios in Rickmansworth and produced an instrumental demo. Missing though was the song's central tearaway guitar riff. Vic kind of questioned what we were doing with the song. He made us look at that riff, so Lemmy and I started fucking around with it a bit. Also down to Mayo's input was the use of woodblock in the breakdown, what Lemmy has since called the tap dancing section. If it was anyone else, we'd have told them to go and fuck off and die, or tied them to the car and run around the car park with them. But because it was Vic, we said, oh, alright Vic. So we're there with these blocks of wood banging them together. He put loads of reverb on, and that's the sound you hear. Depending on what you want to believe, Lemmy wrote the lyrics for Ace of Spades, either speeding down the motorway at 90 miles per hour, or on the toilet. The words all referred to gambling verbiage, mostly dice and cards, from the least desirable role in craps. To the hand Wild West sharpshooter Bill Hickok had when he was shot dead. The Ace of Spades itself often symbolizes bad luck or death, therefore making it the most metal of cards. But Lemmy himself never envisioned any meaning behind the lyrics beyond them sounding cool.
It could mean all things to all men.
Yeah, no
a
doubt.
A good song usually
no
does.
No doubt it does. You know.
A good song usually does.
They probably think it's all kinds of clever metaphors, which it isn't. You know, it's like, it's just a gamble and see if you can do a word exercise and get all this gambling motif into these three verses.
Which probably explains the offhand line before the solo. And don't forget the Joker. A desperate attempt to squeeze one more poker term into the song. The irony, of course, is that though Lemmy did have ample experience gambling, rarely was there anything that was mentioned in the song. I don't have any good gambling stories. I have lots of bad ones. I've lost a lot of money. I'm not a poker player. I play slot machines. I've been playing them since I was about 18, when you were getting into bars. I don't trust any form of gambling with people involved in it. I like the machines better. But then, the Three Red Sevens doesn't have the same ring. Ace of Spades was released as a single in late October 1980 and stayed at number 15 in the UK charts for 2 weeks, resulting in two separate appearances on Top of the Pops. On both occasions, the crowd lost their minds as the band mimed along to their fleet-footed, grimy rock and roll classic. As a result, the Ace of Spades album would be their biggest selling yet, charting at number 4 in the UK. But in a way, Ace of Spades marked the end of an era for the band, though their 1981 live album, No Sleep Till Hammersmith, would top the UK charts. Clark would leave during the sessions of Iron Fist, dismantling their classic lineup. Within the new wave of British heavy metal, Iron Maiden and Def Leppard were the bands who dominated commercially, especially in the US. But Motörhead continued to be a fixture in the community, touring and releasing albums at an average of 1 every 2 years. We didn't sell many albums. I wrote the words to Mama, I'm Coming Home for Ozzy. Mama, Mama, I'm coming home. And I made more from that song than I had from Motörhead at that point. I'm not gonna die broke, but I'm not rich. Nonetheless, the influence is considerable and far-reaching. A lot of US hardcore punk kids got their start attempting to play through Ace of Spades. But UK punks also took notice. Said Barney Greenway of Napalm Death, Motörhead were the first extreme band. That third wave of punk with Discharge and GBH. If you listen to the bass sound on those punk records, a sound like a concrete mixer, that's from Lemmy, nobody else. Though Lemmy himself preferred to be considered a rock and roll band, the metal genre has taken a lot from Motörhead. The speed and distortion of Venom's black metal owes a lot to their sound. A pivotal album in the darker, heavier metal subgenres that would appear throughout the 1980s, as well as preempting the new wave of British heavy metal. Overkill and its thunderous double bass drumming is cited as a precursor for thrash. Said Dave Lombardo of Slayer.
From Motörhead was the first time I heard double bass done at that pattern. I've heard of other double bass drummers, but I don't think they did anything like that at that tempo and that style of beat.
So no Motörhead, no Metallica, Slayer, Megadeth, Anthrax, Testament, Sepultura, Creator, or any other thrash bands. Most unlikely of all, the boss battle theme from Final Fantasy VII, cribs from the band. But for the average music fan, Ace of Spades will remain the Motörhead song, a crossover hit that has become the perfect, mimetic depiction of destruction and rock and roll abandon. Whether appearing on The Young Ones, or soundtracking Tony Hawk Pro Skater 3. Lemmy was never 100% sold on the song as their monolith. Ace of Spades is unbeatable, apparently, but I never knew it was such a good song. I'm glad we got famous for that rather than some turkey. But I sang the Eight of Spades for 2 years, and nobody noticed. Lemmy died on the 28th of December 2015, 4 days after his 70th birthday. He was a man who predated rock and roll, heard its birth wails, decided this is for me, and devoted his life to the cause. The week after he died, Ace of Spades appeared once again in the UK charts, at number 13, its highest ever charting. Lyrically, it may just be throwaway, a challenge to see how many gambling idioms he could fit into 2.5 minutes. But that riff, that beat, Lemmy's bass rumble, the way he barks every line, adrenalizes like nothing else. The pleasure is to play. It makes no difference what you say. Thanks for watching. So is Ace of Spades your favourite Motorhead song? If not, what is? Let me know by commenting down below. If you like this video, like, subscribe, and why didn't you also do me a favour and share it with a couple of people? It really does help. Also, I'd like to shout out all my supporters over on Patreon. Thank you so much. And I'll see you in 2 weeks' time for something I promise is not an April Fool's.